Hello there. Good morning and welcome to my little artichoke chorner. It's not a chorner, it's a corner here on YouTube. And it's a lovely bright sunny day here. There's just a few tiny little white clouds in the sky that I can see. And it is morning in the UK. It is just after 10 o'clock in the morning. I was a bit late getting my backside into gear today. It varies from day to day, but you know, it's life, isn't it? So I'd like to say thank you and welcome. And thank you for joining me here. And I hope you enjoy this video. I'm going to take a look at a Zentangle pattern called Aquafleur, which is one I've not really had a look at much at all, if ever. I don't think I actually ever have. So this is going to be interesting. I have actually tried one video already and I made such a mess of this pattern, you would not believe it. But I'm going to persevere and give it another go. This is my first attempt and I've really got myself in a right pickle, in a right state here, but I've learnt from it. So rather than persevere with this one, I thought I'd start again and share with you perhaps what I've learned about this. The first one being, spend some time to really look closely at the deconstruction, and I will give you a link to the deconstruction from Zentangle themselves in the description box below the video. So I'd just like to say thank you to everybody who's subscribed to the channel. I appreciate that very much. It's just a simple click and it's totally free to do. It's the equivalent of follow on Facebook. And if you click the bell, you'll be notified when I upload a video, which is most days, though sometimes it can get a bit random when I do upload them. So please bear with me because life does happen occasionally for me away from art, so you know, such is things. So thank you so much for that, I appreciate it so much. And here what you can see in front of you is a 6 inch by 6 inch piece of sort of sandy coloured paper. This is actually Murano paper from De La Rowney, which is designed for chalk pastels. Possibly, I'm not sure if it's just chalk pastels or wax pastels, but it's for drawing on as well. And it's not really for wet media, pencil more than ink pens, but hey, I like to live close to the edge. So with Aquafleur, you start with a random shape. And that is well random. It is. And I've done it in pencil because I'm not a fan. I could fill everything in black. We'll see what happens. So I'm just going to choose a point along this shape to start drawing from. And I think I'm going to choose this one. And it really doesn't matter where you start, because you start by first picking a point along the line, the curve. It can be anywhere on the shape. I'm starting with this little indent here. And you draw a line that goes like this. And we do want that line to... Ah, this is what I've been doing wrong. I've just noticed. Right, okay, so I'm going to go this way. And I'm going to work backwards on myself here, because we want two lines like this that are basically sweeping out and then coming back on themselves. So it's an S shape, and the S shape looks almost like it's hugging this outer edge. So I'm just going to connect these, and I'm going to connect them top to top like that. So we create that enclosed space. So I'm going to carry on working this way. I think it doesn't matter as long as you're consistent about how you create these spaces or these lines. So I'm going to add another one there. And I'm going to connect these together in pairs as I go along, because this was something I missed. So, and there comes a time where you have to make a decision whether you carry drawing along that line. My line's got a bit wonky, but that's okay because this is part and parcel of it all. So I'm continuing to create these spaces. I think I have mucked it up for myself by doing it this way round, but we shall see. I trust the process, I think, and we'll see what happens as I carry on. And perhaps once you start one way, you've got to keep going the same way round. So that's better. Just by adjusting where my paper is, I can get a better swoops and curves going on. You might see that here in this one. So I'm going to join those. So this one may end up looking a bit different to the official Zentangle one because, as I say, they came back and curved it round this way, more like a strange C shape, and I'm going with S's. So perhaps I'll try the other one at later on in the video and see how that works out for me. And you can see the difference. As these are becoming less S-shaped now and more like a curved line with that hook on the end. And you just keep on going. Okay, so I'm changing the shape quite a lot here, because the line just wouldn't fit in this space if I carried on. So just do what you need in order to get these lines to continue around. Now that one I've done there because these are going to be coloured in black in a moment. So I've got another one here, and I've got one here. And then I've got this whole huge space here. So what on earth am I going to do about this space? Well, I'm going to carry on adding these shapes inside here and just allowing them to spiral around in the same kind of way as before. But I'm not putting those hooks on the end, because this will end up looking like it's behind everything. As if this falls, we've got layers going on here now, and it'll all come out, I'm sure, when we add. That's a very strange one. But it is what it is, and with things like this, it's best not to overthink if you can help it. So I've got all of this done. Now I need to join these spaces in between. And to do that, I'm going to take, you can see the line that's left here, the one that is hooked over. I'm going to start underneath it to create that little shape there, if that makes sense. So, like this. And what I'll do is I will zoom in. Hopefully I can zoom in, press the right button, Angela. No, wrong one. Let's try the plus sign to go in. So I'm going to start from this one and I'm going to curve this up. And then this little hooked bit, I'm just going to create a little hump like that. I'm not going to bother with that one, because that one I could, if I change that shape, and then that's there. So here, if I do this one around, we'll fill that in, and I'm just going to keep on doing this until I've got no more of them left, where there's no gaps around the outside, everything is filled in. like so. Like so. I always find it interesting to explore new patterns. Even if I make a mess up, I learn a lot about myself, if not the pattern. So this one was Angela rushing to do things and not really following the deconstruction or looking at it closely before I started. But it is what it is. So now the next job is I've got this thicker pen out here. It's a Fudenosuke pen of a kind. It's a brush pen, and this one is by Zebra. I don't know what they're called, but you can see there. Now then, this is the hard thing, is you can see these ones that've got like the little lines in them where I drew the pairs of lines and joined them. So this is where I am going to add the black. Now I'm doing this, I'm thinking, oh, perhaps I should have done this before I connected all of these around. But once you've got the first one in, you're just alternating spaces. So it's black, white all the way around. So bear with me while I do this. Okay, so I was talking about learning new patterns, new ways of doing things. Is that this is one way of getting to this shape. Most probably if I'd persevered or not made such a hash of the other one. I know exactly what went wrong. And what went wrong was, I managed to reverse the direction that I was doing these little hooks, you know, curves with hooks on the end, around the outside. And that's where I ended up with that big black space, because I couldn't work out how to split that space up. Or I just went ahead and did that without thinking about it. So be careful you don't suddenly change the direction of the hooks. I'm sure it could work, but I'm just not sure quite how at this time it would work. But learning new patterns or working with new patterns is always interesting, because it makes you stop and think about things. You sort of like, you learn a way, you start to learn how to analyse patterns, how to look at the essential parts of a pattern, see how they go together, even if somebody's done the deconstruction for you. And you start to learn more about how patterns are constructed. And it's practicing the ways of making these shapes and other things. I most probably have, I know I've done this before, because this pattern reminds me of peppered to a degree. It also reminds me a bit of a pattern called Dragonair. Pepper is an official Zentangle pattern. I don't know who did Dragonair. But there's Draw Wings as well, which is a bit like this with these shapes. And Senna as well is a bit like this, but it doesn't have these hooks on in the way. But I think there are so many patterns that are related one to another. It's very easy to create variations of a pattern and end up with something that's completely different just by changing a little something. And sometimes you're starting with a different pattern, you make a variation, and as you draw the pattern, as you complete it, you think, hang on, I've just done, but from a different direction or in a different way. And that doesn't mean that you've done anything wrong. It just means that there's multiple ways of arriving at the same kind of pattern or in the same kind of to the same kind of pattern or the same feeling of pattern. And that's fascinating to me. And whereas the deconstructions are one way of working and learning about the pattern, that doesn't mean it's the only way of doing it. And I know that it's important that you find out how it works for you. Sometimes it's watching a video of how somebody does this And where I've struggled with things, especially, at Tripoli, vexed me so much for so long. And yet suddenly I watched a video and suddenly pieces fell into place. And then one day, just by accident, I discovered that I'm much better off if I actually draw all the individual triangles in rows rather than trying to do them in a circular fashion, one to the other. And that works for me in a more organised kind of way. I'm not saying the other way's wrong, it's not. It works. And it works for me if I want a particularly random kind of gridded Tripoli, I suppose. One that's more lots of shapes, variation in shapes and sizes, and sometimes even numbers of the Tripoli around the central points. So instead of having six, in some you might have five, in others you might have seven of them. It all works its way round. This is going to be interesting, and I think I just have to go with what's here, and I am going to. This one needs to be black, but it doesn't actually run into the other one, even though they touch. Why am I having trouble filling this in? So there's always something new to learn. And it may be that at the moment, when I get to the end of this, I might think, actually, I'm not very fussed on this one. I don't think I'll use it very often. But at least I can say I've done it. Now that's going to be interesting, because this is going to run into these. And I think you just have to trust, as I said, just trust the process. Follow it through, see what happens. What I could have done there was to split this and have smaller ones. But this is an odd shape because it's not the same kind of shape as the others. The shape has changed. But it will work out no matter what. So I'm beginning to see where there are highlights, shadows needed as I'm working this. I don't have a very good sense of that usually until I am able to stand back, take a look from a distance, or come back with fresh eyes. But I am aware of a number of layers, and here it's going to look like it's spiralling away into this central space here. And yep, I did make sure that happened. Okay. So that is my basic Aquafleur. But there are some other things I'd like to do. One of which is I am going to put a narrow border on. I'll start with one side of these and then I'm going to see what happens, because they are going into this area. I'm doing it on the outer curve, but so this is the inner curve, this is the outer curve, and I'm going to be consistent all the way around. So I'm turning my paper to make sure I do that. I'm not a big fan of turning paper generally, because normally I'm working on A4 paper and a sketchbook, which is a pain to turn, but I do as I need to. And I just think that something like this just adds that bit of, right, let me go to this one. Because then I'm starting here to go back inside. And what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to put one on the outside there as well, because that seems to make sense to me to do that. Otherwise, it's the only one of these black areas that doesn't have that on. So it's that consistency, it's making sure that everything is the same. My colouring in black isn't brilliant, but it will do. And even on these tiny sections, I'm still going to add this border, this edge here. And then in here, I'm just going to put a little circle. I'm just going to tidy up some areas as I see them. So that's beginning to work quite nicely. Now I have options. We always, always have options for things. And I think one of the things I may do is that in these spaces here, I have got the ability, if I wish, to put patterns in there, don't I? But what? My obvious one is going to be something along the lines of, I think I might do it actually, is perk. And perk is where you start with one circle. You can start at the ends. I'm starting in the middle because I'd rather like this to add to the feeling that we've got something here that is sort of going up and down. And I'm going to fill these little gaps in here. I think that might be a mistake, but we'll see. And I'm nestling these little perks in between, or behind each other rather. And then that, with the largest one there, makes it feel this is really curving outwards. So I'm going to do that in all of these, kind of. Here it's a bit different because I want to avoid adding too much black to this section, especially on the black side and at the base, but I think it'll work out fine. Again, it's me being overthinking things, perhaps. And here I'm going to put a complete one here. And just squashing them in behind. And just letting this space allow them just to diminish in size. So there we go. So I'm going to add a complete one here. And just keep going. So I have to admit, this is one of my favourite ways of filling spaces on things that are quite organic. I use this quite a lot myself in my own work. It's not the only way I do it. I mean, anything you can fit in here, something like a mucha would look quite good, and perhaps I'll do one every now and again, maybe. We'll see. But anything that you can fit in would work. It's not critical what it is. We're just adding some pattern and texture here. This will end up looking like a crazy seashell or sea urchin in some way. And that's why I think the little round circles or these perks, these orbs stuffed in here, will work well. You know, with sea urchins, you get all the knobbly lumps and bumps on them. Then this will work well as a suggestion of that. Not that this looks like a sea urchin per se, but, you know, like some sea creature like that. So this does take a little while to do. And I could stop the video and start again once I've done it, but as the spaces get smaller and smaller, it speeds up. So I've done most of the big ones, and sometimes it's nice just to watch things grow in real time. It's quite relaxing. I like watching videos where people, you see a process from beginning to end in real time. I think I could draw the line if it was several hours long, mind you, but see, in these little spaces, even there, I didn't there, because that was one of the first ones I did. But as I've gone along, I'm adapting and changing what I'm doing. And they'll become the dominant part, and the ones where I haven't done that will just disappear into obscurity in the whole of the pattern. Let's fill that one in. When it gets down to being really tiny, you can just get away with little arcs that come back on themselves, or just little lines that split that space up, because it gets ridiculously small unless somebody's going to look at it with a microscope. That's not the word I was looking for. Microscope will do. You know, some magnifying glass. That was the word I was looking for. They're not really going to know whether you've drawn them completely or not. You look at paintings of things like trees that people have done. They don't paint in every single leaf. They give you an impression of what the texture looks like from a distance. And that's exactly what's going on here. It's not like I'm using the finest pen in the world either, because it's not. But I do like these pens. They've got a plastic nib, a bit like the PNs, the Micron PNs, but it's not the same, it's different. It's a little bit softer, I think, and a little bit more pointy on the end. So it does tend to wear down if you're heavy-handed and you use rough paper to draw on like me. But I don't know, it just feels nicer. I find the PNs just that bit hard feeling. So I guess it's somewhere in between a Micron, which is quite soft, and a PN. So it's beginning to get quite interesting here, isn't it? With this. Getting there. Just a couple left to do. Just thinking, you know, my head goes to weird things. I'm just thinking this time, last week, I was looking forward to a day at a steam gala. Steam trains. It seems like an eternity ago, in some ways. But there'll be others. There always are. So I don't know what I'm doing this weekend. I do have something Sunday evening that I need to attend. Nervously. As I'm still worried, in a way, about COVID. If I can avoid having it, I will. I've heard of too many people. It's given them long-term health problems. And I think we can all do without such things. But seems that last month or so has been the time for me to start reacquainting myself with the world in different ways. Or, you know, I'm still exhausted from last weekend, though. That's the only problem. It's being around people for that length of time has really drained me. I'll be fine. I recover. So there's my Aquafleur for now. Okay. I do want to add some other stuff to this. Now then, shading is going to be the thing. So shading and highlight. So I've got my pens here. I have got a blendy stump here. So I'm going to add shadow to these perks to begin with, and I'm just going to do it quite simply on either side of the balls, these things, and I'm just going to smooth this out. Like so, because it will give that just that hint of shadow. And I will come back and I'm going to add some highlights because I dug out the white charcoal pencil for that. So bear with while I do this. Maybe quicker if I go around and add graphite to them all. This is a Prismacolor Ebony. It says jet black extra smooth, so it's a graphite pencil and is blacker than the average pencil. It's not matte like the matte pencils, but it blends a lot easier. But it is blacker, and I think that's why I like it. I forgot I had these in my stash, to be honest, but I rediscovered them and I thought, ooh, let's see what happens with these when I use them instead. And I'm thinking, okay. These have become my favourite ones. I think it's because they are blacker than the average. But I like them. There's still a hint of shine with them, but it's not as noticeable as an ordinary graphite pencil. And just thinking about here where I'd like the shadow, because these spaces are quite small, so I'm thinking about on the top, underneath that white line, might be the place to put that shadow. Just to help, so just go in and smooth these out. You may have to bear with me in a moment while I go scurrying to go and get a bottle of gold ink. So I know where my dip pen is because I was using it the other day. Because yes, I could use a gold jelly roll or a Signo gold gel pen, or even better would be a gold glitter pen. But they tend to have lines that are quite broad, and I really don't want to go outside my black lines here with any kind of metallic ink. So my mind is thinking on these things, even if I'm not acting on them, you know. So my mind thinks on these things as I work without me actually realising it for a while. So I'm certainly not planning out at the beginning. Because until I've done something, I don't really know what I want to do with it. Which is always fun. Always got the unexpected that way. So that really has brought that to life, I think. Okay, I'm just going to have to clean the end of this. I've shown this before, but if you have paper stumps or even the tortillons, I don't have a tortillon here at the moment, piece of sandpaper, and you rub the end along the sandpaper. It cleans it up, but you can also reshape it and repoint it. And I just keep a piece of masking paper on there to collect all of this dust so it doesn't contribute to dust in the house in any way. And when it no longer sticks to the dust, that is when I change it. I'm quite frugal with things. Okay, so I am going to pop some white chalk down the centre of these. maybe not all the way to the end, because the ones at the end will be in shadow, but I am trying to create it so it's wider at the widest point, so towards the region where we've got, like here, where that one bulges out. And again here, got here. And this will really start to lift these then. Okay, so clean ends, which will become mucky quite quickly because there's graphite here, but I do just want to soften this out. And those black lines of the perks, I've got a choice. I can spend ages going back over them with pen, which I may do, but I won't do on camera, or if I do, I might do a couple of them, just to show you the difference it makes, because this does mute the black lines. But part of me quite likes them muted, because it just adds to that feeling of that glow or reflected light. Because reflected light does soften dark things, or the lines become softer. So there we go. There's a little bit there as well. So that is quite spectacular. I'm going to go and find my gold ink. So you can't come for a walk with me, but you can hear me walking and moving, because I know exactly where I popped it. There it is. One has it. Ew. Right. There we go. I've got Liquitex ink here, and where is my, I can't see it for looking, oh there it is, it was hiding. So I've got a dip pen here, I think it's a speedball holder, I've got a few different ones, but with these inks you've got to shake them up, and they're beautiful, they really are. And I prefer to use a dip pen for lots of reasons. The main one being, I can get really fine lines with it. And what I'm doing here is I'm just using the dropper here to put drops of ink in the back and the front, oddly, of the pen, the nib. And I've actually allowed some of it to go off, because if you have too much, it will drip. And I don't want it to drip. So I'm going to use this pen, and I'm going to put gold lines in these sections. Now this nib is quite flexible, so I'm having to be quite cautious in how much pressure I put on it. Because I don't want to have a line that's too thick, but I just want it to be enough. And I definitely prefer drawing towards me with this, so. You can see how far just that one drop of ink goes as well. If I don't fill the whole of this gap up, I'm not too worried, because it will add some automatic shadow to the edge. So you can see I'm doing this. And then here. That needs a bit more ink, because it's just dry. It does dry up and it needs refreshing quite often. But that's the only pain about using this. But this pen and this ink will work on just about any surface. Talking of surfaces, the drawing board I'm working on, the one that I've decorated, I still haven't spray varnished it, so that's going to be my job while this video is uploading, I think, because it needs doing, otherwise I'm going to wreck it. But I'm so chuffed with it as well. May not be everybody's cup of tea, but it is mine. There we go, that's better. So let's have a look here. No, come on. Start working. Stop being a pain. It's being a pain for me. Some way something has just gone and gone amiss, gone awry a moment. They can be finickety, so. But if you are happy using a gel pen, do that. But I've got this out for another reason as well. There are many brands of gold ink on the market. Some are, like this, are acrylic inks, which give a wonderful gold. Others are inks that are for drawing of calligraphy, and they work well as well. If this is something that you'd be interested in doing. But it's finding the right nib, and for the life of me, I can't tell you what this particular nib is. And there are so many different kinds. It's more a case of you need, you know, it's where you need to experience and use them and see what works for you with them more than anything else. And it's always important to make sure you clean the nibs afterwards. You don't want to leave any ink on them because you will ruin them. But warm water, hot water will just clean them off nicely. And surprisingly, this, even though this is an acrylic ink, even when it's dried, it will come off if it hasn't dried on for too long. It started to dry, clean off. So, just thought some gold here would make that. Just that little bit different, add that little bit of luxury to this. It's always the same. I work on camera and everything goes pot. If I'm working on this on my own, it goes so smoothly. Come on, you can do this, nib. Come on then. There we go. So I don't use these often enough to get into a rhythm of them. But I think it's going to be something I'm going to use more often going forward. Because I really do like adding metallic and shiny touches to things. Especially with the monograms I'm doing, I really want to get some gold into those. And I'm not going to start gold leafing because that would be something extremely silly for me to try to do. I've tried gold leafing things in the past and I'm a nightmare with it. Whereas this works really wonderfully. Said it just takes a little bit of practice to get the pen to work and to work out how it works best for you. And a lot of practice with the flexible nibs. Some aren't as flexible as this one. This one's quite a flexible one. And it is just finding out which ones work for you. The flexible nibs allow you to draw quite easily. Lines of different thickness as you're drawing, so you don't have to go back in and add line weight or sculpt them. Really, I think it's because it's quite warm here and the ink's drying quite quickly. Nope, come on. There we are, just needed a little hint of ink on the tip and it's encouraged the rest to flow. So there we are. And this is just the last bit here. In my set, I've got some other metallic colours. I've got copper and I think there's a bronze, a silver. copper, silver. There's another one. I think it might be, is it steel? I can't remember. But there's also a white. No, there's black and white as well, just plain black and white. So that's all of that done. But what I want to do, I'm going to do it with a gold, hopefully. Just making sure my ink, this is well charged, is I am going to, this is where I could really seriously mess this up. We have a look. No, I think I'll leave that as it is. So what I'm going to do with the gold is I'm going to start, hopefully, I've allowed it to dry for a bit too long, so we need to just encourage the ink to the tip, to the nib end. I'm just going to draw some little leafy fronds coming from some of the nooks and crannies here, as if we've got something growing out from this or behind it. So just like that, and you can see how shiny this is even as it's drying. I've got to be cautious because it will take a while to dry, but I might have another one that comes off here. Come on. So I'm just making very simple leaf shapes with little stems on along here. So I'm drawing most of the vein in and then adding some thickness around it, or as here, drawing the shape and then just filling it in with gold. And you might notice I'm actually using the nib and weight on my nib, you know, pen, hand weight, how hard I push the nib to get different thicknesses of line as well. And I think I might just have another one that comes off here. Come on, you can do this. And a really long one here, just to finish this off in a way, as to add that little bit of interest here. So, and I could do that all the way round. And in some ways, I am tempted to have some coming from this nook here, this nook and this little notch, because I just think that might make some sense. This is really, it's really warm. It's September. Oh, it says it's only 15 degrees Celsius out, but I've got sunshine pouring in, which is making my room a little bit. So I'm going to have one that grows out from here. Now these inks I can use a brush with, and I have used paint brushes with them. But if I want fine control, then a dip pen is what I'm going to go for. I'd rather like to have this just a little bit bushier, perhaps, because there's a lot more space here. So I'm just drawing another stem off here. And I'm going to add some leaves on that. Need some more ink. That one I think could look a bit more leaf shaped. Perhaps I can have another one stem that comes off here just to balance this out a little bit, because it's looking a bit clunky, to be honest. You might hear the nib scratching on this paper because this paper is quite rough. That's a bit better. That feels a bit better. And then I'm just going to add some little dots here and there just to scatter some extra bits of gold around, as if these are sprinkling dust, gold dust or fairy dust everywhere. Seaweed dust. So that'll work in any direction. It's unusual because I've left so much of this page completely empty, but I'm quite happy with that. The last thing I think I might do is I do want to get some of those gold dots. I do want to use the same ink. Going, shall I use gold ink or shall I use a white gel pen on this black? So even here I'm going back and just tidying these up as I go. Now I think I'll get a white gel pen out for this, so let me just put the lid on that. I'm going to find a piece of kitchen towel here, and this is going to be a quick emergency clean because I haven't got a jug of water or anything, but I have got a water sprayer, and so I can clean this, the ink off from the nib on the tissue hopefully, and give it a quick wash with some water just to clean the rest of it off. And that will be my emergency clean. There we go. So I can just clean the rest in here. All right, that'll do fine. You can see it's resting because I forgot to dry it last time, but it'll be fine. They're not that expensive to buy, and if I could see it, I could tell you what type it is, but it's become tarnished, so I'm just going to dry the end here and give it a bit of a clean. And that's my job's a good one on that one, so I can pop that one back in the box, move that one over there. The ink I've put away. So, gel pen. White gel pen. Hopefully in my pencil case here I will have one. Almost positive I do. I do. Okay, so I'm going to put some spots of white gel pen, which I'm just going to get working on there, the back of my hand, hopefully. And I am just going to put some dots down the centre of these black sections just to break that black up a bit. Because it is quite intense, isn't it? Now over here, I need to be careful because that gold ink is still damp in places and I don't want to catch it on my hand or smudge it. And I'm just letting these fall away to smaller sizes towards the end, perhaps coming back and adjusting the size so it looks like it's not suddenly going from big to little. But that is actually also helping with this separation of the sections, because the these white dots don't really link up. I'm trying to keep them going down the centre of these black shapes and getting them to curve in a similar kind of way. But just guide your eye to making sense of these large areas of black as well. But it's that highlight that I like. Yeah, I could have done this in gold quite easily, but as the gold ink doesn't want to flow quite so easily today, I just thought the white might be a better plan. And I could have used a gold, metallic gold gel pen, but the gold would have been a different colour and it would have looked obvious. Whereas this white is a nod to the charcoal that I've used in the highlights of the perks. Like so. And I could have put a white border with gel pen in there, but actually I think I quite like that just how it is. And so the last thing I'm going to do is I am going to have, which way do I want this? I quite like that with these growing up. They're actually quite nice that way, this way. I don't know. Does it matter? I don't know, but I'm going to put my initials here in white. Just so it's mine. So there we are. We have, as well as bright sunshine streaming in now, which is most probably going to affect how this appears. Oh no, I think we're okay. It hasn't crept down to the size of the camera. So this is my take on Aquafleur today. And as I say, I'll leave the link to the deconstruction in the description box. And if I try to catch some light on this, oh, did you see the gold just catch it? There. You can see how much the gold shines and catches the light, and I quite like that touch of gold with the white and black and the brown background. That soft brown background just seems to go so well together. So thank you so much for joining me. I hope you'll give this pattern a go. Don't expect yours to turn out exactly like mine, because they won't, because it depends on where you put your original what the original shape is, where you start putting these curved lines in. And just go with it and see what happens, and trust that it will work out in the end. And it creates this wonderful organic dimensional shape. It's like a strange kind of flower or strange kind of sea plant in some ways, or even a fungus, I guess. But have a go. And if you do, please tag me in social media. You'll find me either as Angela Porter, as Artword, or Angela Porter Artword with some dashes, you know, lower score dashes in between them. It depends what social media platform you're on. It depended what names were available for me to use. So until I see you again, take care, look after yourselves, and above all else, well, possibly, but find time to be creative. Bye-bye for now. Ta-ra. Hoyle.